Hello, everyone. Welcome to yet again another podcast by Mr. Mahan. This is going to serve as a very, very quick, rapid review of gas pressure and the different gas laws that you should have covered in Chem 1. So, this is the first podcast in the gases unit for my AP Chem class. So, without further ado, let's get into it, right? Let's stop wasting hot or producing hot gas and get going. All right. So, again, like I said, we're just going to review very quickly how gases exert pressure. And the movement of gases. Then we'll get into the different four independent gas laws, and then we're going to spend a good amount of time here at the bottom here, and not so much the combined, but big time the ideal. And then the next podcast will tell you about how everything I'm telling you here is completely wrong. So without further ado, so pressure, right, pushing down on you, pushing down on me, is the result of force over area. If you've had physics by this point in your life, you know it's some force over area. That's why things like high heels, ice skates hurt a heck of a lot more. Than something like a Ked or a Sanuk would be if somebody were to step on you, or even like a snowshoesie, even though the force, your weight would be the same, changing the area, you can change the pressure. Well, the same idea happens for gases. And really, this idea of gases and their pressures are the reason why we have these things called winds. It's the reason why any kind of your W, good old WD-40 over here, or any kind of hairspray bottle, any kind of aerosol can of any sort, that's how it works. And you should be able to identify, and I've paused it by now via Edpuzzle and asked you, but you should be able to know, and you should say that gases always travel from high pressure to low. Gases are always looking to get rid of that extra high energy and slow down and go from an area of high pressure to low pressure. And again, this explains why our cans that are under pressure work. This is why we have winds throughout the different parts of the world. Well, temperature plays a role. This is also why we have just the different phenomenon such as diffusion and effusion that we have as well, right? Gas pressure always flows from high to low. As I was saying, this is why we have winds, pockets of high pressure, usually of warm air, come in contact with pressure, low pressures. They try and get in there, and that's what creates winds. This is why when you're up in an airplane, you may see the fable or the old urban legend that if like a even something as small as a pinhole or a bullet hole in a plane would actually cause you to be pushed out. I'm not going to say suck. Science never sucks. It may push. But this is why anytime you ever fly in an airplane, we need to pressurize the cabin so that we all feel the same and we feel normal. This is even how breathing works. So as you're sitting here breathing and watching this video going, oh my God, shut up, Mahan. When we breathe in, actually a ton of air comes into our body. We have some water vapor that comes in. We have oxygen. We have the argon that's in the air. We have the nitrogen that's in the air. We have the hydrogen, even a little bit of helium. All the different gases that are in the air come into our body. But because our body's lacking O2 gas, that O2 gas finds a way to jump into our lungs. I'll let you bio people freak out about your little different corpuscles and all that other fun stuff. But that's also why when we breathe out, we have a high pressure of CO2. We have tons of CO2 outside, but we have very little CO2. I'm sorry, we have high CO2 inside our bodies, but very little CO2 outside because of our brethren and our friends out there called the trees. Right. And this is also why as you climb mountains, it's harder to breathe, yada, yada, yada. So coming back to gas pressure, right? So pressure is a force over an area, right? Well, gas pressure is a force, but it is the force that's applied when these gas particles hit the walls of their container and continue to bounce off. So as these gas particles hit, and every time a gas particle hits the wall of a container, that's what actually applies a force to the wall of the container and therefore creates this thing we call gas pressure. This collision here does not create gas pressure. That's just a collision between two gas molecules, not the walls of the container. There's no area that the force is being applied upon. Now, way back in the day, one of the first things we ever created was a mercury barometer. We simply took a dish of mercury or a bowl of mercury. We filled up a big old tube of mercury. We capped it with our finger, inverted it. And what we noticed, and we created a vacuum. And so what we noticed is as the atmospheric pressure changed, it would push down on this mercury in the bowl here. And that would push that mercury, therefore, further or lower, higher or lower up on our barometer. And we actually started to measure it. So this was our first ever barometer. We have much more technologically advanced barometers nowadays, but it's the same overall idea of using the atmospheric pressure to measure. And what we actually did with the first way we ever measured it was we measured how high up the mercury went in this glass tube. And on a normal or an average day or a standard pressure day, we had 760 millimeters of mercury. That unit was later renamed TOR after Evangelista Torricelli for all of his work that he did in the world of gas pressures. But we also use the unit Pascal, or really kilopascal for KPAs. In America, we use a little PSI to fill up our tires. We never really use PSIs in the world of chemistry or in the world of science, but we will also use atmospheres. All right, so from that, we are under currently or under standard, if you've ever seen that STP, which is also on your reference sheet. Standard conditions is one atmosphere of pressure. The Earth has one atmosphere, it has different layers, but we have one atmosphere covering us, and that one atmosphere is normally 760 millimeters of tor, or millimeters of mercury rather, or tor, which will also be 101.325 kPa's or 14.7 psi. And again, we never really use this, but figured we put it on there. You do not have to memorize these. These are provided for you on your reference sheet for you AP people. All right, so gas pressure. As we get into these four individual gas laws real quick, just things to keep in mind. These are all the different things that will manipulate and create more collisions, and therefore, by creating more collisions with the walls of the container, or less collisions with the walls of the container, will actually manipulate the pressure. The number of gas particles we actually put in there, or N, the pressure itself, we can exert an outside pressure, the volume of the container that we're using, and the temperature, aka the kinetic energy, or the speed of the molecules themselves will also modify the number of collisions. So way back in Chem 1, you should have learned about our boy Amadeo Avogadro. He was the guy that brought pressure and gas particles together. So he changed P and N while actually keeping V and T constant. So he was the no problem guy, no problem. He was the one that simply said, hey, your tire's flat. Guess what? Fill it up with air, put more air in your tire, and yay, great success, more pressure, right? So we found that if you put more gas particles in your container, a la container one versus container two, the more particles I have bouncing around, the more likely I am to have collisions with the walls of the container. More collisions with the walls of the container means more pressure. And we call that a direct relationship because as gas particles went up, collisions went up, and so therefore pressure went up. So as we did the same, or if we lowered the number of gas particles, if your tire's too full, let some air out. Less gas particles, less pressure. So since they do the same thing, we call that a direct relationship. So in came Boyle. Boyle said, anything you can do, I can do better. Anything you can do, I can do better than you. He said, okay, Avogadro, I see you, I see you. I'm going to change pressure, but not by changing the number of molecules, but by changing the volume. So I like to think of Boyle as like a vice principal, a VP, right? And so that's where, or a vice president. And so that's how I kind of remember the Boyle's law. He simply said, hey, if you were to decrease the volume of an object, if you were to squeeze a, or apply an outside pressure to an object, it's going to get smaller. And this is a better picture representation that if I take the same volume that I was under, if I go from a 1 liter down to a 5 liter, I should have more collisions. Therefore, more collisions, more pressure. So what was pretty interesting about Boyle was that he is the only one that actually has this inverse relationship. In his changing variables, he said that actually, if you increase the volume, which means more space, you'd actually have less collision, so less pressure. If you were to decrease volume, as you can see as we go from the first to the second to the third situation here, we have less space, so we're going to have more collisions, and so therefore more pressure. Next up was actually another one of these situations where two different scientists in two completely different parts of the world found out the same thing, and that was Gay-Lussac. I usually remember it as Lussac. It's kind of like a physical therapist, a part-timer physical therapist. Their job is to loosen you up and get you mobile again. So Gay-Lussac, they were the two people that said that pressure and temperature are related if you keep N and V related. And if you think about it, if you take a closed can, you throw it in fire, you get an explosion. Do not do this at home. Let the silly people on YouTube, let them do it and watch it on YouTube if you want. But what we see is on the particulate level, if we heat these particles up, that means we're going to increase their kinetic energy by increasing the temperature, which means we're going to move more and more and more and more and more and more, more and more and more and more and more movements, means more and more and more collisions until we eventually explode. So Gay-Lussac, they were the ones that said that, okay, if temperature goes up, we have more speed, more temperature, more collisions, more pressure, less temperature, less collisions, less pressure. And again, we see a direct relationship. Last one up was Charles's law. Charles's law. I think way back to the day, I mean, I was born in 83. I'm old, I know. I think of Charles in Charge, good old Scott Baio out there. Shout out to Scott Baio. Charles in Charge was a big old TV star. You could also think of Charlie Sheen, that psychopath, and his winning. He was a TV star, or Charlie Brown. He was on TV with Peanuts. He's the TV star. He was the temperature volume person. And he came up with the idea, and we see this. If you've ever worn a piece of jewelry, as the day goes on and as you get warm, your skin, your body, the gas inside swells, and it gets harder and harder to take the jewelry off. If you were to take an object and put it in a higher temperature while keeping pressure and number of particles constant, the volume is going to increase. If you take that same object and put it in a colder temperature, It will actually decrease. So you may notice that doors in your houses get stuck in the summer, but close fine in the winter, and that's why. And so Charles was the TV guy. He came up with the fact that if you increase temperature, that extra energy, that extra speed, if we keep the outside pressure the same, that's going to have to increase in volume and vice versa. If you decrease the temperature while keeping pressure and number of molecules the same, you'll decrease volume. So those are the four different gas laws, and those four gas laws were great. And in Chem 1, you analyze them individually. But then even in Chem 1, we discussed the fact that real life and real gas scenarios and situations, there's a lot more going on. And so we had to find a way to actually analyze more than one gas law at a time. And so the first thing we came up with was what's called the combined gas law. That was P1 V1 over T1 equals P2 V2 over T2. I don't really see this gas law too often at the AP level. This is kind of more something we keep at the Chem 1 level, but I just wanted to put it out there. I haven't seen it on a reference sheet in forever, but this actually brings together Boyle's law with PV, brings together Gay-Lussac, the physical therapist, with PT, and it also brings in Charles's law, the TV star, with PV. So I haven't really seen this a ton, but you never know. You never know what College Board's going to do. But this is our first way of actually starting to bring together more than one gas law and start to really apply the gas laws to the world in which we live. All right, here we go, big time. You need to write these slides down, or this slide down, and the next one as well. So in reality, in real life, what we do is we deal with not just one, not just two, not just three, but all four gas laws at once. And so we had to come up with this thing that's called the ideal gas law, or as your Chem 1 teacher might call it, the Pervenert law. But the ideal gas law, you probably didn't go over in Chem 1, that it looked at the following two things. It looked at the fact that, okay, we need to assume that gases do not actually attract or repel each other, which we know is wrong because of intermolecular forces. But let's pretend gases do not attract or repel each other, which that's huge because that means that anytime a gas particle collides with itself, or if the gas particle collided with the walls of the container, that those collisions were what we call completely elastic. So that means that no energy was lost at all and all energy was transferred in that collision. So if you were to drop a tennis ball from your head, it would bounce, hit the ground, and come right back up to your head, which we know wouldn't happen in reality because of gravity, but we're going to assume that gases do this. The second thing, in order to discuss the ideal gas law, is that the gas molecules themselves, their volume is so infinitesimally small in comparison to the size of the containers that we're keeping them in, that the gas molecules themselves, we just say that they have no volume or that the volume is negligible. And when we assume that gases observe both of these two rules, rule number one right here and rule number two right there, we can now consider them what's called ideal gases. And we can now use the following, and this is why your teachers might have called it the Pervenert law, because this now allowed us to use the formula PV equals NRT. Now, PV equals NRT, and again, you don't have to memorize these, you just have to be comfortable with it, because this is actually on the back top left box of your reference sheet. But PV equals NRT, P is pressure, but here's what's interesting about pressure. Pressure can be in those three units I was discussing earlier, torr, or millimeters of mercury, ATMs and kPas, and they will ask you questions using all three of those. Volume, however, must be in liters. N is always number of moles. We've used that a bunch, but we are talking about gas. R is the really interesting part here, right? R is actually what we call the universal gas law, or this should actually say the universal gas law constant. Sorry about that. That's a typo. PJMMJ exclusive. And again, you don't have to know the values for R. They are provided on your reference sheet, but I wanted to draw attention to the fact that R and P are actually related. I like to think of them as cousins. The value for R that you use is directly related to the unit of pressure that they were providing for you or asking you for. So if they gave you torrs, you should use the 62.26. If they asked for or gave you ATMs, atmospheres, you should use the 0.0821 or 0.08206. And if they gave you kPas, we would use that 8.314. And so R and P are always related. What value for R to use is told by P, or the value for PM's solving for is going to be used or found by R. And with that, temperature is the last part, capital T. And the interesting thing about temperature is that temperature must always be in kelvins or in Kelvin, which, remember, to get into Kelvin, we would take the degree Celsius and add 273 to it. So one little basic, little quick ideal gas law problem to put in action before we let you go with this podcast is to solve the following problem. How many moles of oxygen gas would exert a pressure of 63.3 kPas in a volume of 1.25 liters at a temperature of negative 22 degrees Celsius? Via the Ed puzzle, I'm going to pause it and make you solve it. If you're watching via YouTube, great idea to pause it here and try and use that ideal gas law. All right, so if you did pause the podcast or if you did solve it via Edpuzzle, I got an answer of 0.0379 moles of oxygen. I always like to take the combined or the ideal gas law here, write it, and reorganize. I like to do old school algebra where we actually reorganize. So since I was solving for N, I divided by RT, whatever you do to one side, do to the other. So N is PV over RT. Pressure was in whatever unit they gave me. They gave me KPAs, which is perfectly fine, 63.3. Volume, luckily, they gave me it in volume, so I didn't need to convert. If it was in milliliters, I would have divided by 1,000. Then I use this value for R, and I use this value for R because I was using KPAs in my pressure. So I use the 8.314 KPA times liter, and I left all the units here just to show you how awesome the universal gas constant is. So if you take a look at the math we're doing here, I have KPAs over KPAs, so they're going to drop out. Liters over liters are going to drop out. Then when I multiply my denominator, which where did this 251 come from? I had Kelvin is negative 22 degrees Celsius plus the 273.15, which gave me 251.15. No decimals, two decimals. I'm not allowed to have any decimals, so that's why I dropped them. Now when I multiply out the denominators, Kelvin's going to drop out. So I got 79.125 as my numerator, 2,086.814 as my denominator. And the only units that were left was 1/1 mole. Then when I divided out my numerator by my denominator and rounded to 3 sig figs, because 3 times 3 divided by 4 times 3, 3 is the lowest sig figs. So I rounded it to 0.0379. I end up with 1/1 mole, which we keep change flip, KCF. And so I end up with the 0.0379 moles of oxygen. Now in class, we're going to do a lot of different practice problems with this ideal gas law and discussing gas pressures and that kind of fun stuff. So we'll get into it deeper, but hopefully this video just kind of helped kind of maybe knock off some ring rust with the idea of what gas pressure is. Gases always go from high to low. We got our 4 individual gas laws, and just to kind of remind us what ideal gases are. Now our next subsequent podcasts are going to tell us how all this is wrong. So hopefully you didn't get too comfy with it, but thanks for watching.